In this video, I want to paint a picture of the CisLunar metal ecosystem. This region of space between Earth and the Moon contains surprisingly high levels of metal. It's also the place where metal is needed for in-space construction and even propulsion. In this video, I explain the metal CisLunar ecosystem and the space startups working on moving, supplying, processing, and consuming metal in this region. Many of the space startups that I will be talking about in this video, I've covered already, so check out those videos for details. Using metal in space has a number of advantages. First, metal is strong and used for structural stability for space station modules, satellite buses, spacecraft, robotic arms, and more. In addition, space startups like Neumann Space or Neumann Space are using metal as a propellant, given how cheap, available, and non-toxic it is. So now, let me describe to you a concept of operations for supplying, refining, processing, and consuming metal in the CisLunar region. CisLunar metal ecosystem. Powerful space tugs from startups such as Impulse Space's Helios or Blue Origin's Blue Ring could collect spent upper stages in orbit and deliver them to an orbital foundry located in low Earth orbit. Helios, for example, is designed to haul up to 5 tons from low Earth orbit to geostationary orbit in just a few hours, making it ideal for this kind of task. Other space startups such as Astroscale or ClearSpace are working directly on orbital debris missions and could also assist in collecting space debris for recycling. CisLunar Industries is working on orbital and lunar metal foundries. Directly supporting the concept of CisLunar's orbital foundry is the news that UK startup SpaceForge recently operated a furnace in the vacuum of space, achieving temperatures of 1000 degrees Celsius. That's hot enough to melt aluminium, which could then be extruded or 3D printed into new components, parts, or propellant rods. In fact, CisLunar Industries entered into an agreement with Neumann Drive for the delivery of their pulsed arc thruster propulsion system to demonstrate to the US Space Force what they call a circular propulsion ecosystem. Here is what it looks like using the image from the media release. Servicing vehicles pick up space debris, delivering it to a salvage platform. This platform recycles the scrap metal into metal propellant rods suitable for the Neumann Drive system. Servicing vehicles deliver these rods to supply hubs, such as the Earth-Moon Lagrange 1 supply hub concept envisioned by Firefly Aerospace, or to commercial space stations in low Earth orbit. Spacecraft equipped with a Neumann Drive go to the supply hub to pick up metal propellant rods to refuel. This completes the metal ecosystem, with a full circular system using space debris as the initial source of metal. It's worth noting there is around 10,000 tons of scrap metal in low Earth orbit. Half of that is aluminium, which makes an excellent propellant source, having a fuel efficiency, or ISP, of 2,000 seconds. In addition to orbital debris, upper stages that have completed their mission could, instead of burning up in the Earth's atmosphere, dock with orbiting metal foundries to be recycled into metal propellant rods. Another use for space debris is to send it on a lunar impact trajectory, where the metals could be recycled using lunar metal foundries into useful components and parts for lunar bases and outposts. I've explored this concept already when I covered the orbital recycling startup. One other space startup which I've covered on this channel previously is MagDrive from the UK. They're working on a similar metal drive system to Neumann Space. They describe their system as firing plasma bullets. A plasma stream is created from metal in the same way as a Neumann drive and is accelerated using a magnetic field to achieve a higher exhaust velocity. While these metal drive systems are great for station keeping and collision avoidance maneuvers, they don't provide the thrust for major orbital maneuvers such as orbit raising or sending supplies to the moon. Okay, let's look at the CisLunar supply hub in a little more detail. Supporting a CisLunar supply hub at EML1. In a previous video, I covered Firefly Aerospace's concept of an aggregated on-orbit supply hub stationed at Earth-Moon Lagrange Point 1. This gravitational sweet spot is a balance point between the Moon and Earth, where station keeping costs are very low, often under 10 meters per second per year, making it an efficient waypoint for CisLunar logistics. The supply hub would store supplies, consumables and propellants for use by space tugs and servicing vehicles. Firefly's concept is to send propellant canisters, launched on Starship, to top up fuel supplies at the hub. Empty canisters would be sent on a lunar impact trajectory to build up resource stockpiles on the moon's surface. Crashing the empty canisters into the Poincaré Basin would result in a steady buildup of metals in the crater, which could be recycled into metal components and parts by a lunar metal foundry. Poincaré Basin, located on the far side of the moon, stands out as one of the best sites for controlled high-velocity crashes of orbital debris, according to independent lunar site selection study by NASA. The basin has low scientific value, a 250-kilometer diameter with a depth of 4 kilometers to contain any ejector from impacts, a low slope of under 3 degrees for easy access and exit. It's extremely cold, which would preserve volatiles such as propellants. Near highlands that receive plenty of sunlight are a good location for processing of materials from the wreckage. Rovers would periodically enter the crater to collect debris for processing. Modeling suggests over 95% of the ejecta from a crash would stay within the basin. After a decade of crashes, the location would be a valuable metal mine of aluminium, titanium, and copper, easily accessible with a small fleet of smelter rovers. Gitai, a Japanese space startup, has demonstrated dual-arm lunar rovers that can cut up wreckage or other dead assets and could be used for the scrap metal retrieval process. Initially, Starship or Blue Origin's Mark II reusable lunar lander would make short hops from the Artemis base camp to Poincaré Basin to collect forged metal parts. Later on, a regolith-sintered road network would enable efficient logistics from Poincaré Basin Rim to the Artemis base camp near the lunar south pole. Near-Earth Objects, NEO, M-type asteroids. Orbital debris would certainly be the first place to have its metal, but it isn't the only nearby location. A number of metal-rich near-Earth objects are known and are accessible from low Earth orbit. Three of these objects can be reached, requiring a delta V of 7.5 kilometers per second or less. 1986 DA, for instance, is over 3 kilometers in diameter and can be accessed, depending on launch window, for as little as 5.5 kilometers per second delta V. The reality is, probably Starship or another vehicle capable of high delta V maneuvers would be needed, so mining asteroids for metals will take perhaps a decade or more before it's realistic. Let's look at a way to upgrade those metal drive systems to provide a more robust CisLunar and Martian supply network. Scaling up pulsed arc thrusters using nuclear reactors. The more power available on board the spacecraft, the more powerful the pulses can be, and the more frequent they can fire, increasing thrust to enable missions beyond the Earth's orbit. In addition, clustering a large number of arc thrusters together instead of scaling up a single large thruster provides redundancy. Mass production of metal drives is easy, as mentioned by Neumann Space, and with abundant power from a nuclear reactor, tens or even hundreds of drives at a time can be powered. Off-axis firing of some of the drives can provide a torque to the spacecraft for maneuvering. Another advantage of using a nuclear reactor is that the abundant power available could be used to generate intense magnetic fields that act as magnetic nozzles to confine and accelerate the plasma stream out of the spacecraft. Using superconducting magnets to produce magnetic fields would heat the plasma stream to millions of degrees and accelerate charged ions to 30 kilometers per second or higher. ISP, a measure of fuel efficiency, could be boosted to 4,000 to 10,000 seconds. Let's look at thrust scaling to achieve supply missions to the Moon and Mars using a nuclear-powered, clustered, pulsed arc thruster spacecraft. Looking at this chart, we can see the thrust level using aluminium as the fuel is only 15 millinewtons at a power level of 1 kilowatt. Adding a 100 kilowatt nuclear reactor as a power source boosts thrust up to 1.5 newtons. A second generation reactor rated at 500 kilowatts can produce 7.5 newtons, and a third generation reactor running at 2 megawatts can produce 30 newtons of thrust. While this is very modest compared to chemical thrusters, a nuclear-powered craft could fire continuously with very high fuel efficiency. Changing the metal used can boost fuel efficiency further, or improve thrust at the expense of a specific impulse. This chart is linked to in the description, and you can play with the parameters or change the metal propellant to see the results. At this point, it's worth mentioning K2 Space, a space startup working on large satellite buses, rated for high power. Their first mega-class satellite will be launching in March 2026. This satellite has twin 10-kilowatt solar panels to power a 20-kilowatt ion thruster. This is four times more powerful than any ion thruster flown in space before. They have plans for an even bigger giga-class satellite bus that is rated up to 100 kilowatts. Their satellite bus has been designed from the ground up to provide substantial power with all the systems rated for high power electronics. Using a K2 satellite bus with a cluster of pulsed arc thrusters and swapping the solar panels for a nuclear reactor produces a nuclear-powered spacecraft running on metal propellants. With a high-end nuclear reactor rated at 2 megawatts, it can provide cargo services to and from Mars. As a NASA study on nuclear electric propulsion to Mars in 2021 states, a pre-crew cargo mission could deliver 200 tons to Mars using a one-way spiral trip with a transit time of 535 days. The study is linked in the video description. MagDrive in July 2025 signed an agreement with Perpetual Atomics to pave the way for nuclear-powered plasma propulsion in space. Although this appears to be using radioisotope materials for power rather than a nuclear reactor. In short, there is a path to evolve metal propellant drives to shuttle supplies around CisLunar space and even to Mars, all running on metal propellants which are plentiful in low Earth orbit. Final thoughts. I used to think the CisLunar economy would be powered by water, electrolyzed into hydrogen and oxygen for fuel, and harvested from the moon and near-Earth asteroids. Now, I'm thinking that metal-based propulsion with on-orbit recycling offers a more immediate and practical foundation for a CisLunar economy. It's hard to overlook 10,000 tons of potential fuel just sitting there in low Earth orbit, exactly where you want it to be. Building space tugs that use metal for propulsion avoids the massive upfront investment needed for harvesting lunar water ice and the complexities of cryogenic storage of liquid propellants in space. Harvesting space debris for fuel has the added advantage of greatly reducing the collision risks of operating in low Earth orbit, which increases with every year that passes. Using metal for propulsion has lower technical barriers than cryogenic fuels, with recycled technologies already proven. Spaceforge has demonstrated operating a furnace in a vacuum at far higher temperatures than is needed for melting aluminium. While for high thrust scenarios, the water-based architecture is still valid, for supply missions in CisLunar space and perhaps Mars, metal propulsion drives work well and are available today. In addition, sending some of the orbital debris to the moon allows for lunar-based construction without having to ship resources from the bottom of Earth's deep gravity well. What do you think about a circular metal ecosystem in CisLunar space? Is this the right way to clear up orbital debris while providing fuel for space tugs and metals for in-orbit and lunar construction projects? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week, or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I received, along with previews of upcoming content. If you've got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.